morning and welcome to worship. Will you please stand with us as we begin together by singing hymn 381, Open My Eyes That I May See. How precious is your steadfast love, O God. The children of mankind take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your delights. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light do we see light. Psalm 36, 7 through 9.
Thank you. Good morning, church. Wonderful morning to be worshiping together. We have a number of people who are absent from our congregation this morning because they're up at camp, and they are up there getting ready for the camp season, which is a wonderful time for our church where we get to be able to support all the ministries up there, and so many of you go up. And some of you perhaps have seen the Lord working in your lives this week. I was just talking to Nate, and they apparently had a miracle happen to get them all the way to camp in their vehicle, and so that was a great experience to be able to see that it could have been much, much worse that happened, and perhaps you've seen something like that in your life this week. Perhaps God has worked in your life. You've seen something happen where God was taking care of you, obviously, and shepherding you, and what a wonderful thing to acknowledge that our God takes care of us on a daily basis. So as we come and we worship Him, I want to invite you to stand up and greet your neighbors around you. Good morning. This is Pastor Brett Siegelkoff from Caldwell First Baptist Church. So glad you tuned in today. Today we're going to be talking about breaking down the barriers that we have with other people. I hope you're encouraged by it and that you are blessed. If you do have any questions about our church, please contact us. Our information can be found on the web, and we would be happy to pray for you if you do have any prayer requests. Hope you have a blessed day. We can make it back to our spots. We have the verse of the month, Psalm 56:4. And it reminds us that if God is for us, who can be against us? When God is working in our lives, we have no reason to fear anyone else. And when we sing those praises, then we declare that to be true for ourselves. So let's declare this truth together, Psalm 56:4. In God, whose word I praise, in God I trust, I shall not be afraid. What can flesh do to me? Psalm 56:4. You may be seated. We have some announcements this morning.
Let's see. Do I get to play microphone games again this week? Looks like it's going to work. Awesome. Hello, my friends. Good to see all of you this morning. If any of you are visitors today, brand new, have not been here before, we would be delighted if you would see someone in the Welcome Center, which is the booth just outside these doors. It says Welcome Center over the top. You won't miss it. And we have a special gift for you if you'd like to kind of check in there. We'd love that. Also, there are communication cards in the back of the pew right in front of you. If you could fill that out to let us know you were here today and have a visitor, we would love that. Even if you're a regular attender, you may use those cards to communicate with the church if you have a prayer request. That would be a great time to do that. Abby Antosh is going to be the registrar now for Warm Lake Camp. Isn't that exciting? Richard Bishop has been our registrar for years, and Richard, we'd like to thank you for years of wonderful service. Thank you so much. And his service continues because he is passing the torch to Abby. So he is going to be working together with her this year to make sure that she understands all the ins and outs. You can direct your questions to Abby. Abby's here today somewhere, right? Where? Aha! Abby, will you stand up so everybody knows what you look like? Okay, this is Abby. Yay. So if you've got questions about camp, she's your gal. You're going to want to talk to her. This is great news. Early registration for camp has been extended by 1 week. So today, instead of last week, today is the last day to register for camp and get the early registration price. Now, you can still register for camp, but after today, you won't get the early bird price. So see Abby about that if you possibly can, and give her your checks and all your registration information. The children's booth in the lobby, which is adjacent to the Welcome Center out here, is where you're going to want to go between church and Sunday school or after Sunday school in order to catch up with Abby. So, the Camp Scholarship lunch, which was held last week after church, after Sunday school, was a marvelous success. Thank you very much to everyone who participated in that. That was a fundraiser for the younger kids who want to go to camp but don't have other ways of earning their funds to be able to make it to camp. Now, the youth are going to be doing something similar, but they're going to hold a yard sale in the church parking lot to raise money for camp. That is going to be on June 15th from 8:30 a.m. to 5 p.m., and you can drop off items here at the church between 4 and 8 p.m. on Friday. That would be this Friday coming up, June 14th. Just leave it here so that they can get that stuff set up for the sale. And if you need more information on that, there is more detail on the church's Facebook page. This is the last day to rescue your belongings from the lost and found. So, if you've lost something important, please go check the lost and found table. If you don't know where it is, it's down the short hallway on the way to the restrooms upstairs here near where the drinking fountain is. Go check that out and see. Even if you haven't lost anything, go look. You might find something good. Who knows? Anything that is left there after today is going to be donated to the Grace Place. Ladies, the new year for Secret Sisters begins the end of June, and we don't want you to miss out on the opportunity to bless and encourage one another. The final day to register is next Sunday, which is also Father's Day. Registration forms are in the library, or you can see Nana Wagner for that if you want to get connected. Next Sunday, Father's Day, is also the last day. Seems like we've got a lot of deadlines in the announcements today. Next Sunday is also the deadline to return your bottles for the Lifeline Crisis Pregnancy Care Center. You remember the baby bottles that you take home around Mother's Day every year and you fill them full of change and so forth? That bottle should be getting nice and heavy by now. But the nice thing is, even if it doesn't weigh very much, you can put checks and cash in there. Yeah, and you know what? The Pregnancy Care Center will like those just as well, I promise you. So if you'd like to donate and you don't have change, stroke a check, grab some paper money out of your wallet, stick it in that bottle, and bring it back here next week, and leave that at the information booth, the Welcome Center. Okay, more information in the bulletin. Please don't forget to read that because there's always good stuff. One last notation is that there will be a business meeting after the service today to discuss the assistant pastor position. So members, we encourage you to stay. It won't be a very long meeting. If you're not a member, feel free after church to either sit for a few minutes if you want to just listen in, or you can slip quietly out the back and have some coffee in the library while we wait for Sunday school to start. Thanks.
Well, this is the time of our service where we get to give offering. And so we want to prepare our hearts and ourselves for that as well. And we're going to pray to the Lord right now. And then after I'm done praying, if you have any little ones, then they can be dismissed for children's church. Of course, this is always optional, but we provide this for the time during the sermon. Well, they will go downstairs and actually learn the same biblical text that we'll be preaching here today. So that will be happening after the prayer time. The kids can just walk right to the back, and we'll go ahead and escort them to the right spots. So would you bow with me in a word of prayer? Our dear Lord, we want to come to you, and we want to ask that you would come minister to us this morning. We know from your word that you are the good shepherd. And when we follow the good shepherd, that we will have no want, we will have no things that we will be lacking that we need, because you provide all that we need. Lord, you make us to lie down in green pastures, and you lead us beside the still waters of your peace. You give us everything we need spiritually and physically. But not only that, Lord, you restore our souls. And we pray for that this morning. We pray that you would restore our souls. Some of us come here brokenhearted. We come here with questions that need answering. Lord, we come here wondering what now, Lord, in our lives when there's been radical changes, some not so radical. But Lord, you say that as the good shepherd, you will lead us on paths of righteousness for your namesake. Lord, I pray that you would lead us on that path of righteousness. Take us in your holiness to where you want us to go, Father. And we know that no matter what happens, we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we don't fear because you are with us. Your rod and your staff, they comfort, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, that you can help us to sit in peace, Father, that even if we're surrounded by our enemies, Lord, that you anoint us with oil, Lord, and that cup overflows with your grace and your blessing. And when you are with us, who can be against us? And Lord, we know that when we follow you, you will lead us in goodness and mercy all the days of our lives to the very point where we shall leave this earth and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And we long for that day. We long for that day when we can see you face to face. Help that desire to be ever before us. Help us to want that desperately, so that we are heavenly minded. But Lord, let us also remember that Jesus is coming back. And we pray that we would long and look for that appearing, that we would every once in a while just look up in the sky. Every once in a while we would be longing to hear the trumpet sound and know that we're going home. And we pray this in your name. Amen. Thank you. Would you open up your Bibles to Acts chapter 10 today? Acts chapter 10. Continuing the story of Peter and Cornelius. And I'm just wondering if I can get a show of hands here. Who here has been to the Ronald Reagan Library in the LA area? Wow, really? Okay, all right, great. So I've been there twice, and it is a phenomenal place. They call it a library, but I don't remember seeing any books there because it's basically a museum, and I know they have a library. I just haven't seen it there, but they have this wonderful museum. And it's like walking through time, and this is, you know, during the period when I was growing up as a kid and remembering a lot of the news reports, but walking through all those things again is wonderful. In the Ronald Reagan Library, they have a scale model of the Oval Office, so you can actually stop and look and see what the Oval Office actually looked like with his articles that he actually had in during his time. And so it's wonderful just to go see that. And they have all kinds of different things. They have a podium that has the presidential seal, and you can stand there and act like you're the president, you know, and pretend, which of course everyone was doing. And then we move on, and then there is the apex of the whole museum, which is this hangar, which actually has his Air Force One jetliner in that museum. And so you get to walk through a 1980s version of the Air Force One, which is great because they actually have phones that have cords, you know, and things like that. But it's wonderful. And then they have Helicopter One, and you can actually see the helicopter that he used to get around, which was just super cool. And then you go to the you take this track as you walk through, and of course you end up in the store. And then you can buy all kinds of neat presidential things in the store. You can even buy a pen that has Air Force One that slides to the one side. You know, when you lift it this way, it slides back. And you can get that sort of thing. And the whole experience is just wonderful. But if you take a walk outside to the back patio of the library, you will see a solitary stone. And this solitary stone is out there, and it's covered in graffiti. And it has big rebar, you know, poles, wires, sticking out and protruding out of this thing. And then you go up and you read the plaque and you realize that that is a piece of the Berlin Wall. And as we know, Ronald Reagan had something to do with the downfall of the Berlin Wall. And perhaps you remember his speech where he said, "Mr. Gorbachev, take down that wall," right? And how many of us watched when the Berlin Wall actually was taken down? Do you remember seeing that? How many of us? Wow, okay, most of us here actually remember seeing the Berlin Wall being taken down. Decades it existed, and then one day it finally came down. And it wasn't just a symbol of division. It was division. It was keeping families apart. It was keeping people from reconnecting with others. And it had a complete divide within this community in Germany. And then when that finally came down, it was like the world rejoiced that now these people were united. These people who had been divided by this wall had now been able to come back together. Well, we love it when walls that divide come down. And today we're actually going to be talking about a more important wall than the Berlin Wall that was taken down in the book of Acts. Now, this wall was not a physical wall, but it actually created physical divisions. It actually was a wall that kept people physically apart as well as relationally. And what it was the wall of hostility between Jews and Gentiles. It was a wall of hostility between God's chosen people and the Gentiles. And so when we get to this text, this may be one of the most pivotal parts of the book of Acts, because that wall in this text officially comes down. And then the book of Acts will take a whole new tact as it moves out from the mostly Jewish world to the mostly Gentile world. And so we're going to see a major shift in the book of Acts. And this is actually the last time we'll be in the book of Acts for a number of weeks, so it'll be a great place to end on as we see the progression of the gospel going out from Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria and to the other ends of the earth. Now, as we look at this story, there's a couple things that become evidently clear about what God was doing, and one is this. We see that Peter is the central human figure in this story. And of course, it had to be Peter that is involved in this story. We've already been introduced to Saul, who will become Paul, but Peter still has something to do. You see, Jesus had told Peter, he said, "I'm going to give you the keys to the kingdom." And he had given him a command of what to do with those keys. And so he had taken those keys, and he first went to Jerusalem, and he used the keys to open the door to the people in Jerusalem. As he preached the gospel, and 3,000 people were saved in one day. And so he opened the door with the keys to the people in Jerusalem. Next, he opened the door to Judea, and they went out from Jerusalem into Judea and used the keys to open the door to enter into that realm and to preach the gospel in that region. We see that with Aeneas and Tabitha as he went out into farther regions of Judea. As he healed Aeneas and Tabitha was raised from the dead, and then people all in that region got saved. We see a little bit in between those times when he went also to the Samaritans. As Philip was reaching the Samaritans and they were coming to faith in droves, and then they asked Peter to come, and he was able to authorize what was happening, that this wasn't some separate work of the Holy Spirit. This was part of the same church that was working in Jerusalem amongst the Jews. The Holy Spirit is now working amongst the Samaritans. And so he makes it official and declares it to be official, and he uses the keys yet one more time. But there is still a last time that he needs to open the door. There's still one more door that needs to be officially opened by the Apostle Peter as the church becomes more and more inclusivistic and opening themselves to more and more different types of people. And that may be the largest door of all, at least population-wise, and that would be the door to the Gentiles. You see, though Paul is called the missionary to the Gentiles, it's actually Peter who opens the door to them. He's the one who opened the way. A fascinating truth, as he was so primarily involved with Jewish people, he is also the one who opened the door to the Gentiles so that the ministry could pour forth into those lands. But it didn't just have to be Peter, it also had to be the Holy Spirit. We're going to see here that it's the Holy Spirit that is actually the main character in this story. He is the one driving this ministry to the Gentiles. He is practically forcing Peter, you'll see, into opening the door for the Gentiles. He really doesn't want to do it, but all of these things have to come into effect in his life before he will do it. But then when he does recognize it's the Holy Spirit who's opening the door to the Gentiles, he's all in and is fully behind it. But it proves what we've been saying from the beginning in the book of Acts. That is that the Holy Spirit is a missionary spirit, even though we may not be missionary. And so what the Holy Spirit is constantly doing in all of our lives is he's pushing us out of our comfort zone into being missionaries and ministers to people outside of our realm. And that's really the main focus of what we're doing today. So what we have here in this text is we have here the breaking down of three walls. Or you could even look at them as one wall in three different ways. But let's take a look at these three different ways that God breaks down the wall so that the gospel can go to the Gentiles, of which we are all thankful, right? Because we are all products of this very text. If this hadn't happened, probably none of us would be here right now. So this is an origin story. And so we're going to get into this and talk about the three walls that are broken down. And the first wall that was broken down is the wall of association. The wall of association. There's a wall that everybody has of association, and that is that all of us determine who we will and who we will not associate with. And so we have these walls, and we naturally associate with people that we like or people that are like us, and we normally disassociate with people for various and sundry reasons. Now, a Jewish person had a wall towards Gentiles in that they would not enter a Gentile's house. They would not spend time much with a Gentile. As a matter of fact, there were certain laws about this. There were certain national laws that created a barrier for a Jew to be able to have a relationship with a Gentile. But it wasn't just one-sided. Gentiles strove to not enter into a Jew's house because, generally speaking, the Gentiles were anti-Semitic. They had a bias against Jewish people. And you would think that today this would be at a lower ebb, especially after World War II, but I would tell you that it's not true. As we've seen synagogue after synagogue attacked in our very own country, we can see that the wall of hostility still exists between these two people groups. And so let's take a look at verses 17 through 23 as we continue the story from last week. Just as a reminder, Cornelius had a vision. And he is supposed to go send some people to find this man named Peter, which he then does obediently. Around the same time, Peter has a vision, and in this vision, there's a sheet dropped down from heaven, and there are all manner of animals in it, and this voice comes that says, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." And he rejects this. He says, I've never eaten anything unclean. But the voice comes again a second time. And he says, what God has made clean, do not call common. And this happens three times. And then it was taken up at once. And so our story starts right in the middle of this section. And we see that Peter is confounded. He's trying to figure out what exactly is happening. Verse 17. Now while Peter was inwardly perplexed as to what the vision that he had seen might mean, behold, the men who were sent by Cornelius, having made inquiry for Simon's house, stood at the gate and called out to ask whether Simon, who was called Peter, was lodging there. And while Peter was pondering the vision, the Spirit said to him, behold, three men are looking for you. Rise and go down and accompany them without hesitation, for I have sent them. And Peter went down to the men and said, I'm the one you're looking for. What's the reason for your coming? They said, Cornelius, a centurion, an upright and God-fearing man who is well spoken of by the whole Jewish nation, was directed by a holy angel to send for you to come to his house and hear what you have to say. So he invited them in to be his guests. The first thing we notice about this idea of expanding our associations is that the Spirit commanded Peter to travel with and enter into relationship with these men who had come to the door. Notice that the Holy Spirit yet again has to talk to Peter and command him. Notice what he says. He says, behold, three men are looking for you. Rise and go down and accompany them without hesitation. He knows that Peter is going to hesitate. He knows that Peter is going to be actually breaking Jewish law by associating with these Gentiles. And so the Spirit is saying, you need to look beyond those things and you need to associate with these individuals because the reason they're coming to your house is because I sent them. Now, they actually have they give a resume of Cornelius. They say he was a centurion, he's upright, he's God-fearing, well spoken of by the whole Jewish nation. And so that's very important because it's important for Peter to know that Cornelius is a God-fearer. He's one who follows God. He knows God from the Old Testament. Perhaps he's looking for the Messiah, we're not sure, but we know that he's a God-fearer and that he's respected by the Jews. So we see that the Holy Spirit selected Cornelius very well because he was able to get Peter to say, well, you know, he's not a pagan Gentile. He's one who's a God-fearer. And so he worships the same God that I do. And that opens the door for Peter to be able to go do that. And it overcomes Peter's hesitation. But really, truly, it's the Holy Spirit who puts all of these things together that says, go without hesitation, go and associate with these men. And then he realizes that the Holy Spirit is guiding him to do this very thing. There's something we learn from this. And that is that the Spirit is in the business of bringing associations with people that we would not normally associate with. Perhaps you've seen this in your own Christian life. Perhaps you find yourself associating as a Christian with people that you have not normally associated with. I remember reading in a story about a Middle Eastern country. And in this country, which was primarily Muslim, there was a woman there who was Muslim, wearing her burqa, and she was instructed by the God of the Bible to go find this individual Christian. She was told what he would look like and be dressed like, and so she knew exactly what he would look like and where he would be. So she went to this marketplace to go find this man, and she recognized him immediately because of the description. And so she walked up to this man and introduced herself. And she says, do you know God? Now, this man happened to be a Christian living in a Muslim country. And a Christian living in a Muslim country has to be very careful about how they interact with Muslim people. One of the things that he was very fearful of was that sometimes the government would actually send people to reveal who Christians were and see if they were trying to proselytize Muslims, and then they could be arrested. Because in some countries, that's against the law. Not only that, but he was afraid this was also a trap because maybe she recognized that he was a Christian and wanted to see if he'd reveal it and then talk to him, which it was improper in a Muslim community because a man who is not married to this woman should not be talking to a married woman. And so he was afraid that this was a trap. He did not want to associate with this woman, in other words. But she came up to him and he says, who told you this? And she said, Jesus. Jesus told me to find you. Tell me about this Jesus. So he says, okay. And the Holy Spirit confirmed in him that this is legit. And so he takes her to the side and they go sit and they talk for 3 hours explaining the gospel. And though she is very hesitant at first, she says, this is who I want to follow. I want to follow this Jesus. Now, this is the way the Holy Spirit works. The Holy Spirit leads us to associate with people that we might fear, that we may not normally associate with. This is exactly what he's doing with Peter. He's saying, go not because you know them or you're comfortable with them, but because I sent them to you, and I want you to minister to them. I wonder in our own lives how many times that happens. How many times has God led you to talk to someone that you don't want to talk to? It happens to me invariably when I'm on an airplane, because a lot of times I get on an airplane, as long times it's been a long day, and all I want to do is put on my headphones and I just want to tune out, listen to some sermon, you know, about reaching people. That's what I want to do. And then there's somebody sitting next to me who's like, hey, what do you do for a living? Okay, all right, earphones out, let's go. Okay, Lord, I guess you're doing something here. Right? Have you ever had that happen in your life? This is not somebody you're planning on associating with. This is not somebody you're planning on getting in a relationship with. But the Holy Spirit creates this opportunity for us to walk into. And so Peter takes it. Peter goes. He says, he actually invites them into his house to be his guests. Gentiles. He invites them to be guests. You see, he's associating with them. He's actually breaking bread with them. He's actually fellowshipping with them. So that leads us to the second thing we see here, is that Peter fully associated with these people once the Spirit worked in his heart. So he invited them in to be his guests. So here's the thing. Even though the Holy Spirit leads us and guides us, we can't be used by God unless we're open and willing for the Holy Spirit to lead us to people that we might not normally associate with. You know, that means breaking down some of our own walls. We all have walls, don't we? We all have social walls. They're not visible, but they're walls, and they're 10 feet high. They're walls that we have in our families. They're walls that we have in our friendship circles. They're walls that we have at work. And there are these walls that you can't see or I can't see, but they exist. And you know what I'm talking about, because you've tried to associate with other people, maybe even at this church. And you try to associate with people who are maybe in your own family, maybe who are friends, but you realize there is a wall. They are not interested. They have their people group. They have their people that they associate with, and they're not looking to step over the wall. It's 10 feet tall. It's 3 feet thick. And there are people they associate with and people that they don't associate with. And brothers and sisters, I want to encourage you this morning that we as Christians should not have a wall about who we will and will not associate with. There should be no wall, because Christ is breaking down the wall. He is making it so that we should be willing to talk to and engage with anyone that the Holy Spirit leads us to engage with. They may be a different culture group. They may speak a different language. They may be a different gender. They may be someone who is making moral decisions that we would completely disagree with. But if we really believe that God is working in other people's lives and he's actually calling sinners to repentance, then what means that we would be willing to associate with those very people. So we've got to break down the wall of association. The second wall to be breaking down is the wall of bias. The wall of bias. Let's take a look at what happens next. Middle of verse 23. And the next day he rose and went away with them, and some of the brothers from Joppa accompanied him. These are circumcised Jewish Christians from Joppa. And he says, why don't you guys come with me? Let's see what's going to happen here in Caesarea. So on the following day, they entered Caesarea. Cornelius was expecting them and had called his relatives and close friends. When Peter entered, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshipped him. But Peter lifted him up, saying, stand up, I too am a man. As he talked with him, he went in and found many persons gathered. And he said to them, you yourselves know how unlawful it is for a Jew to associate with or to visit anyone of another nation. But God has shown me that I should not call any person common or unclean. So when I was sent for, I came without objection. I asked then why you sent for me. The first thing we see about this breaking down the wall of bias is that Peter had to work through Cornelius's bias, because Cornelius actually had a bias that we don't usually think of, and that bias was that he thought too highly of Peter. So sometimes we can have a bias not only of thinking people are too low below us, but we can also think that people are too high above us. And this is actually something that the church has wrestled with throughout the history of the church, the glorification of Peter. Peter has been exalted in the church over and over again as somebody who is greater than the average person. But notice what Peter does to adjust this relationship. Because what we see here is that Cornelius, it says that he fell at his feet and he worshiped him. And for a Christian, that's wrong to worship any person. That's bias. That is saying this person is greater than I am. And so as he falls at his feet and he worships him, Peter says, "Hey, I'm just a man. Just knock it off. Please, please, please just stop. I'm just a person. God is God and I am not." A lot of people need to know that about Peter. God is God and Peter's not. Peter was just a human like you and I, and he did the will of God. That's it. He was an instrument of the king. He was a servant of the king, and we are all servants, right? All of us. So he brings that to bear. And so we have this tendency, we can do this too, where we actually elevate people above others and think of them as great and grand. Sometimes we do this in the media. Sometimes we do this with our leadership. We do this in many and sundry ways, but we have a bias. And what Peter's saying is saying, don't do that, because we're equal as human beings, and so I should never be worshipped. Who should be worshipped? God, right? God alone. But second, Peter taught that not only should you not be biased up, you shouldn't be biased down and think people are below you. Peter taught both Jews and Gentiles that God has revealed to him that he is not biased. So look at what happens here. He talks to them, he says, "You yourselves know how unlawful it is for a Jew to associate with or to visit anyone of another nation." He said, there are laws that I am breaking by being with you today. And I'm recognizing that before you Gentiles, you know that I am breaking the law. We actually have laws that create bias, is what Peter's saying. And he's saying, I'm breaking those laws, those human laws, to associate with you, even though my countrymen would completely reject me now because I'm doing this very thing. Think about the bravery of Peter at this moment. And this is why the Holy Spirit needed to work in him, because the Spirit's saying, I want you to do that. I want you to cross over this barrier. I want you to break these laws, because these laws are not from me. Because God is not biased. So he tells them, God showed me something. God has shown me that I should not call any person common or unclean. And what he means there specifically is uncircumcised. To be circumcised was to be ceremonially clean and to be able to worship God in the temple. And he's saying, that's what we called you, was you were the uncircumcised, you were the unclean, you were the ones who were not ceremonially prepared to worship God. And he says, God has shown me that I can't say that about you anymore because it's not true. This is a radical change in the way that Peter understood life. And so Peter, you can imagine, he's just going through this massive transformation. And then he goes on. And he says that I was sent and I went without objection. And then this is what Cornelius says. And Cornelius said, 4 days ago about this hour, I was praying in my house. At the ninth hour, and behold, a man stood before me in bright clothing and said, Cornelius, your prayer has been heard and your alms have been remembered before God. Send therefore to Joppa and ask for Simon, who is called Peter. He's lodging in the house of Simon, a tanner by the sea. So I sent for you at once, and you have been kind enough to come. Now therefore, we are all here in the presence of God to hear all that you have been commanded by the Lord. He relates the story that we already read last week, but he's reiterating to Peter that the reason I'm even associating with you, Peter, is because the Holy Spirit has guided me, that God has guided me to talk to you. And so God has guided Peter to talk to Cornelius. God has guided Cornelius to talk to Peter. God wants to do something. And so he says this. They both realize that God has brought them to this moment. And so it says, the conclusion here is he says, so we're sitting here waiting for you to tell us what God has commanded. This is every pastor's dream. We're just sitting here waiting for you to tell us what God has commanded. Notes, pen in hand, right? We're ready. We're ready, Lord. So Peter's, oh my, he's ready. He's ready now to do this. And I just want to remind you before we get into what Peter's about to say is that notice who's gathered in this group. We have Peter, the Jewish apostle to the Jews mostly at this point. We then have Christian Jews from Joppa. We have a number of them there who they aren't used to this at all, totally out of their comfort zone. We have Cornelius, who's a respected centurion Gentile, a God-fearer, and we have his whole household, his family, who also seem to be God-fearers, and then we have his close friends. We have a big group, and they're from all these different backgrounds, all these different biases, and all these different perspectives. This was a group of natural-born enemies. Isn't God awesome? He's about to do church. He's about to change these guys into something that from natural-born enemies to fellow brothers and sisters, a family. He's about to create a family out of natural-born enemies. And how does he start? He starts by declaring that God was offering the gospel to all people. Notice what happens, verse 34. So Peter opened his mouth and said, "Truly, I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him." That is good news. Now, what he's not teaching is that everybody who does the right thing goes to heaven. Doesn't it kind of look like that there? He says, in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. Well, we know that's not true with the gospel. What must he be saying? Well, this is continuing the idea that if you seek God, you'll find him. If you're seeking God, you'll find him. And how will you find him? In Christ. And so he's saying, for all those who are seeking God, the gospel is extended to those people so that they may find salvation through the gospel. And what he says, every nation, those are powerful words, every nation, anyone who fears him, any person from any nation can now believe in the gospel and join the family of God. This is a powerful, powerful message because now it becomes clear to all of those people present that Jesus is not just the Jewish Messiah, but he's also the Messiah to the Gentiles as well. And so at that moment, the wall of hostility between the two is now breaking down. We can see the daylight in between. The wall is just coming down quickly. And here's the thing, brothers and sisters. It's the same wall that needs to be taken down in our lives. That we have to be there too. We have to be able to say that for this very reason, I also must not be biased because God has opened the door. It says here, God shows no partiality. God shows no partiality. Did you know that God is not partial? I said it earlier, God is not biased. Now some of us are going, wait, I thought he had a chosen people. Well, he did, but it was never his intent to only work through the chosen people. God was always reaching the nations. That's always part of the plan. It's something he described to Abraham in the Abrahamic covenant. They would be a blessing to all nations. God always intended that to be the case because God is not partial. God is not partial. So if God is not partial, how can I be? And if I want to be like Christ, then I have to be impartial to people. This week I was talking with a member at our church, and they said that they used to live in Utah, and as they lived there, they went to a neat church, and they were there for like 20, 30 years, and they actually went through a number of pastors. They went through quite a few pastors. And they said, yes, we had some really great pastors, but we had one pastor and his wife that should have never moved to Utah. And I'm very inquisitive, so I said, really? Tell me about that. I said, should he have never moved to Utah? And they said, well, because they didn't like Mormons. They lived in Utah, and they were fearful of the Mormon people. They were separating themselves from the Mormon people. They would not associate from those people. And so what they would do was even like if they would have anything that said anything that was Mormon on it, they would go hide it in the closet, which is very tough to do in Utah, I understand. Like a bag from a store that's owned by Mormon people. And the reason why they should have moved to Utah was that they felt that they were too holy to connect with these people. They were biased against the very people that they had come to live among. And what we're talking about was that even people in the church who were believers in Christ, all of their relatives were Mormon, so you just couldn't get away from it. But somebody who goes into a place like that, you have to do what? You have to love the Mormon people. You have to love them. Right? Because God is reaching them. If you have a church in Utah, you're reaching the Mormon people.
Because God loves them and wants us to reach out to them. And so if God loves people that maybe are uncomfortable for us or out of our comfort zone, we're called to love them too. And we have to get over that wall. We have to break down the wall in our own hearts because God has already broken it down. The wall has already been broken down by God. The way is open. And so we got to go through it. We got to reach across the aisle to those people. Which leads us to the third wall that needs to be broken down, and it's breaking down the walls of ignorance. And I want to add about God. Breaking down the walls of ignorance about God. You see, being willing to reach out to people, being willing to love people is only half of it. Because the other part of the wall coming down is that we actually have a message that they need. There's a lot of people who are loving to people who are not like them, who have no message of hope. Brothers and sisters, we cannot miss this. We have to also not only reach across the aisle to people who are not like us, but we have to reach across the aisle with the gospel. Amen? If we don't have the gospel, what hope can we offer people? We have to give them God's message. So listen to this sermon, by the way. This is pretty awesome because as Peter now preaches a sermon, the Holy Spirit actually cuts him short, says, oh, you preached long enough. So this is going to be a partial sermon. But notice how he starts it off, verse 36. For the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news of peace throughout Jesus Christ, he is Lord of all. Now, this wasn't exactly getting to the point that the Gentiles were probably looking for, because he says, there's a word, and it was sent to Israel, and it was this word that's the good news of peace through Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. So now he's setting the stage to understand that Jesus is the Lord of all, Jesus is the Prince of Peace, Jesus is the Savior, and this is the message, is the gospel is Jesus, and it's sent to Israel. Now that could make them hesitate a little bit, right? Oh, it's sent to Israel. It's not sent to us. But he's not through yet. But what he wants us to understand is Jesus was sent to Israel. He is the Jewish Messiah. And his message is a message of peace. The key word there is peace. The message is peace. What does that mean? It doesn't mean that Jesus gives you rest in the sense that you just, you know, life becomes smooth and easy. The peace that was offered through the gospel is peace with God. That if we don't have Christ, then we are God's enemies. But when Jesus Christ comes and he makes atonement for us and we believe in it, then we are at peace with God. We are now in relationship with God. We are now restored to God. We now have a connection with God, and we are brought into his family. That is the greatest message anyone can hear, brothers and sisters, that you are at peace with God. Think about this for a moment. Everyone lives in fear of not being at peace with God unless they have an unquestionable reason to believe otherwise. Everyone is fearful of what God thinks about them if they believe in God, and sometimes they don't believe in God because they're fearful if he did exist that he'd be mad at them. But everyone lives in a fear of not being at peace with God unless they have an unquestionable reason to believe otherwise. You see, that's why so many people, when an angel shows up, they just fall in fear. Because there's, oh no, God's mad at me. Oh no, I remember that thing I did last week, now I'm getting in trouble. God is calling in what I did, and now I'm being held accountable. So there's this fear that people have of God, and perhaps you know what I'm talking about. Every once in a while, you might get a little bit of that, where you feel like, oh, God's going to zap me. You know, you see a lightning storm, and you're like, oh, that's for me. God's coming. But everyone has a fear of not being at peace with God unless they have a concrete reason to believe otherwise. And this is it. He says, you want a concrete reason to not live in constant fear? Is that Jesus came to give you peace. And when you have the peace through Christ, then you are completely in God's favor. And it's called grace. So now he's going to shotgun through this, and he's just going to go right through this. And he's going to talk about this peace that is offered. I'm going to go through this rather quickly like he does. He says, you yourselves know what happened throughout all Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John proclaimed. So we see that this showed that goodwill of God towards his people, that he was proclaiming himself and he was doing good things. What did he do? It says how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, and he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. So he's freeing people, he's loving people, he's bringing peace. But then something bad happens. It says, verse 39, and we are all witnesses of all that he did in both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. And so then they could be thinking in their hearts, oh no, is God now mad at us because we did this, because the Jewish people did this, and now he's mad at all people? And so they put him to death on a tree. But verse 40, God raised him on the third day and made him to appear not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. Wait a second, they put him to death, but then he rose from the dead. He came back from the dead. But who did he show up to? Did he show up to the people that killed him? No, because they're not at peace with God. He showed up to his followers, the people who believed in him. And is he angry? No. He says he shows up to the chosen ones. They were the witnesses. And what do? They ate and drank with him. The true picture of peace, the true picture of fellowship. Jesus has now paid the price for his chosen ones, the people who follow him, and peace is had in those people. And what does he command them? And he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. It's all about being at peace with Jesus because he's the judge. He will judge the living and the dead, and so our relationship with Christ determines our future. What a wonderful picture of the peace that comes through Christ. And so this message was the final brick that needed to come down in the wall. This was the final thing that needed to come down to be destroyed so that now they can proceed with the message to the Gentiles that God is offering peace to all through Christ because though he died by the hands of evil men, he was raised to new life. And so we get to the apex here, verses 42 and 43. And he commanded us to preach to the people, testify he is the one appointed by God to be the judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. That's what they were looking for. And can we have peace, they're thinking? He says, for everyone you can have forgiveness. Everyone. No bias. Opportunity for all. And now we Jewish apostles are declaring this to you. But that was the end of his sermon. I don't even think he was done. Look at verse 44. While Peter was still saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. And the believers from among the circumcised who had come with Peter were amazed because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. Many people call this Second Pentecost. Second Pentecost, because all these Gentiles are there, and all of a sudden the sign of tongues happens to them. Verse 46. For they were hearing them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter declared, can anyone without water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have? And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked him to remain for some days. He preaches the gospel of peace. Immediately the Holy Spirit comes on them as they're believing in their hearts. And they all start talking in tongues because they've received the gift of the Holy Spirit. They have now been brought into the church. And still, there's enough of a wall there. Well, this is what fascinates me about the end here, is that Peter actually challenges the Jewish Christians. He actually calls them out and says, can any of you say that we shouldn't baptize them now? Do we have any reason to be biased any longer? And then it says, very interesting in verse 48, and he commanded them to be baptized. Some of your translations say he ordered. Do you know he had to order them to do it? They were so resistant to break the Jewish laws. But now the Holy Spirit had made it abundantly clear that they must accept these people as believers just like they are. And so we see the Holy Spirit working to bring people to him through the gospel. You know, I had a friend who was a teacher in high school, and he was a history teacher, and he found out that I was a church history major, and so he talked to me, and he says, look, why don't you come one day, and you come teach my students about the early church? And he says, look, here's the thing. He says, I cannot teach the gospel in my class, but my guest speakers can. Wink, wink. Oh, okay, I'm a guest speaker. So I come in as a guest speaker to talk about the early church, and they were talking about the Romans and how they were interacting with these church people because we know that the Romans were persecuting the church and all it did was make it grow. And I explained to them that the reason it grew was because when the Romans would persecute the Christians, they wouldn't retaliate because they followed the Prince of Peace. And so they would respond, when they were given hate, they responded with love. And so the Romans, basically a lot of them watched it and they converted themselves. And I remember telling them, and I told them why. I said, because Jesus offers peace through the gospel so that his love goes out to his enemies are transformed into friends. And I remember talking more, and I went more into depth in the gospel about the death and resurrection. And all of these high school students, you know what they did? They just sat there looking at me and blinking like they had never heard this before. And then it dawned on me, they haven't. They haven't heard it before. Brothers and sisters, we live in a time of ignorance. We live in a time where people, even if we reach across the aisle, they don't know the message. They don't know the gospel. It needs to be proclaimed. It needs to be taught, because all people know about Jesus is that it's a cuss word. All that people know about the gospel is the word gospel. All they know that the Bible is a book. All they know is a church is a group of people get together for an hour on Sundays. They don't know. And so reaching across the aisle and breaking down the wall is saying, I will not only reach out to you, but in my hand I will produce the gospel. I will have in one hand the hand of friendship, the other hand, the gospel. Because when I share with them the gospel, then they have a message of peace and a message of hope. And that's what breaks down the wall of ignorance to God. And so these Gentiles who were going, teach us. The only reason they got saved was because they heard the truth. They believed the truth. The Holy Spirit came on them and transformed their lives. So brothers and sisters, I leave you with this. The Holy Spirit is working powerfully in us. And as the Holy Spirit works, he will drive you to reach out to people that you would not normally reach out to. And the onus is on us to say, yes, Lord, I will follow. I will follow, and I will break down my 10-foot-high social wall, and I will go out, and I will spend 5 minutes talking to somebody that I don't have time for or I don't think I have time for. I will spend time talking to somebody that I don't know very well. I'm not even comfortable with them. But God, I will do it. And the reason we will do it is because we will surrender to the Holy Spirit. So the question for us this morning is, will we surrender to the Holy Spirit as Peter did? And he said, I'm speaking to you because I surrendered to the Holy Spirit because he led me to do this very thing. And when we do, we are going to see God radically change this community for Christ. Would you bow with me in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that you are a God who is without partiality. I'm so thankful because that's the only way I'm here. That's the only reason I'm saved. That's the only reason any of us are saved, because you offer the gospel freely. You offer the gospel to all. And so I pray, Lord, that we would be your hands and feet, and we would express that same message that the gospel is to be offered to every soul. There is no one who is undeserving of hearing the message or our attempt to reach out to them, Lord. There is nobody too high, there is nobody too low. I pray, Lord, that you would give us an impartial heart, give us an unbiased heart, Lord, and a love for people beyond what we see from them, Lord, and a love that supersedes that, which is the love of God. We pray that we have that in our hearts more and more each day. We pray this in your name. Amen.
Oh, church, thank you, Father, for the worship that you give us in your word. As we respond in song, this is our opportunity. As God softens our heart, true learning comes with a change in behavior. Peter demonstrated that, right? He learned a change in his address to the Gentiles, and his behavior changed. He went and he did something with it. And as we listen to God's word, as we sing praise to him, I pray that our hearts would be softened and that there would be a change in our behavior, that we would learn something this morning and go and put that into practice. Would you stand with us as we sing in the name of God? Abba, Father, living water, shepherd, servant, king. Our songs this morning are singing praise to God in the names that he gives us to sing praise to him. The name.
Servant and King, Master, Teacher, Lord and Keeper, Counselor, Prince of Peace. Almighty Creator, Emmanuel, Savior, Adonai and the Rock. Hosanna, Messiah, Yahweh, Jehovah, Alpha, Omega, God. Friend and healer, Christ Redeemer, great is your glorious name, Jesus the name. Abba, Father, living water, shepherd, servant, and king. Master, teacher, Lord, and keeper, Counselor, Prince of Peace. Almighty Creator, Emmanuel, Savior, Adonai and the Rock. Hosanna, Messiah, Yahweh, Jehovah, Alpha, Omega, God. Friend and healer, Christ Redeemer, great is your glorious name, Jesus the name. Christ Redeemer, great is your glorious name, Jesus the name.
This next song is Agnus Dei, Alleluia, for the Lord God Almighty reigns.
Hallelujah.
Before you. You are God and we are not. Father, I pray that we would bow before you today and this week, that we would associate with those that you would choose that we would associate with, that we would welcome in love and, Father, bring the gospel, that we would boldly proclaim the forgiveness that we have, Lord, that we would be gentle with brothers and sisters in the faith, encouraging and proclaiming your name. In this building, in this church, outside these walls, in this community, that all would know that you are God. Father, you are holy. You are the Prince of Peace. This last song we're going to sing, we're all together. Well, no, sorry. There's echoes at the beginning. The guys are going to start, the ladies echo. And then next slide, Shane, those are all at the same time. So the guys are singing, I will sing to and worship, and the ladies get all those wonderful names of the Savior. We had the opportunity Friday, Saturday, there's a few people still up at camp for work camp. Just a ton of stuff got done. It was a wonderful time of fellowship and work and snow. We woke up to snow Friday morning. Snow, rain, hail, sun, snow. So it was camp. It was good times. But what an awesome God we serve. You are holy, you are mighty.
Mighty, you are worthy.
Thank you so much for coming and worshiping with us this morning. We're going to have a quick business meeting, so if you're a non-member, you're free to slip on out and hang out, wait for Sunday school. If you're a member, please stay. We continue worship as we work together as a body. You're dismissed. Let's do the Iowa. You are holy.
You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
Peace, and I will live my life for you.